Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Alhamdulillah. I can't hear myself anymore. Too many lectures in my life. First of all, there are too many Georges in this city. I'm not from Georgetown University. I'm from the George Washington University. Another one of the Georges. Thank you very much for the introduction. Tonight I'm going to speak about my own ancestor, after whom I'm named, and on his birthday I was born, the 3rd of Shaban in Iran, in Tehran. I'm a Persian. I very rarely give this kind of lecture, only twice, three times in my life, once in England and twice in the States, one in Canada, once in New York. But tonight I felt somehow, after a long time, I've not been giving a public lecture, to have the Imam, inshallah, accept our worship to God on the occasion of his martyrdom, being our present to remember not only him, but what he meant. So let me begin with the significance of Imam Hossein. This is itself rare in human history. When a figure, like anyone else, is born in a particular society, in a particular city, in a particular family, that rises to a level beyond all accidents of birth, place of birth, language, ethnicity, and becomes a universal figure. Such is the figure of Imam Hussein. Putting the prophets aside, he's one of the very rare figures known from Beijing and Kuala Lumpur to Mauritania and the Atlantic coast and every land in between. His life, all of you know. Besides, I want to say to you, I'm not a Rosa Khan, I'm not going to make a cry. But I want to discuss in a more scholarly way something about him. Born in Medina, raised in the household of the Prophet, his mother Fatima being the daughter of the Prophet, and he being so beloved to the Prophet that the Prophet invented his name. The name Muhammad, Hassan, Abdullah, these are names that exist in Arabic already. The first person we know in history was called Hussein is Hussein. And when the Prophet saw him, he said, he's a little goodness, little beauty. And that's what Hussein, Babu Fa'il, in Arabic means, actually, from the word Hus, meaning both beauty and goodness. It's one of the most important words of the Arabic language and other languages like Persian and Urdu and Turkish, which use this term. He lived both a glorious and a tragic life. Glorious in the sense that the Prophet called him the apple of his eye. And the Prophet was ruling over a whole part of the cosmos, the ruler of the whole world, would get on his four hands and knees and would give him, I hate to say piggyback, right? But anyway, ride on his shoulders. That's how much he loved him. And this love bore with him all of his life. But a moment came in his life when, having gone in patience through the caliphate of Muawiyah, when his older brother Hassan was Imam in the Shiite sense of the term, he no longer accepted the allegiance of Yazid. And you all know what happened. He set out from Karbala to Iraq, where the people of Iraq, of Kufa, invited him. But they reneged on their invitation, actually. But he knew he was going to his death already. And the most important thing that he left behind, writing word that he left behind, is famous Dua Arafah, which many of you have read, which he read, recited before setting out from Mecca to Karbala. And all you know, on the 10th of Muharram, he died on the battlefield outside of the city of Kufa, which is now the city of Karbala, one of the great citizens of pilgrimage in the world. Those who've had the honor to visit it and have made pilgrimage there, I have many times. And what a remarkable sight it is just to behold the Zari and the dome, the cupola of Imam Hussein's tomb. Strangely enough, he has two tombs. His barakah was so great that God made it possible for him to have two tombs. Now, how does that work? As you know, he was beheaded. And the head was taken by Zainab, his sister, to Damascus, to Muawiyah. and Muawiyah, to Yazid. And Yazid was scared, and he said, I didn't order his death, and had Shamr put to death, the person who killed Imam Hussein, put to death, and exiled Zainab, you know the famous sermon, and the khutbah that she gave in front of Yazid, which was one great masterpiece of the Arabic language. And no time in Islamic history has a woman given such an eloquent khutbah. She was a person of unbelievable mastery of the Arabic language, and all of you who know that khutbah know what, that itself is like a miracle. And so that scared Yazid and they exiled her. She went to Egypt, and according to most historians, some of the Persians don't want to accept it, his head was buried in a, near the city of Fustat. And from this one head grew the biggest city in the Arab world. All of Cairo is built around the head of Sayyidina Hussein. Sayyidina Hussein in Cairo is a great center of pilgrimage. For 25 years I visited it when I was exiled from Iran. I still am exiled from Iran. I got a replacement for my homeland. So I know the site very well. I spend every night there, every night. Even when the close is at 8, I got permission to spend time there with my students, and there are unforgettable moments. You cannot deny the tremendous barakah that is there. Some of my Persian compatriots say, oh, no, no, his head was brought back and buried in Karbala. I do not accept that. I accept the verdict of Islamic history that his head was buried there. There's no effect without a cause. You cannot have millions of Muslims going to pilgrimage for the head of Sayyidina Hussein. Even in the old days when the relations with Iran and Egypt were good, many Iranian pilgrims. Khan Khalil al-Bazar is named after a Persian. Khan, Khe Alif Nun is not an Arabic word, it's a Persian word. And the bazaar right next to Sayyidina Hussein was named after a Persian merchant. They visited it for centuries. And it's a very, very important site. And sometimes the Egyptians joke with us. He said, like, you are Shiites. Except you are Shiite al-Huzn, we are Shiite al-Farah. You cry all the time, but we smile. a lot of Persian in the audience, I hope you're not offended, I'm a Persian myself. But there has some point there. There's a sense of joy, he said, in Hussein, which is really remarkable. The sense of tragedy of Hussein's death is felt in Karbala. There's a lugubriousness in the air. We feel a kind of sepulchral beatitude of death and of the grave, of resurrection, of sacrifice. And so this itself is one of the most remarkable facts. There's only one other person in Islamic history who has two centers of pilgrimage, his sister. All of you have been to Cairo, know that Zainabiyah is one of the two biggest mosques, and Sayyidina Hussein, the most important mosque in Cairo, visited by many people, especially the poor, especially women. It's a women's center of appeal to Allah Ta'ala. And then, of course, is Zainabiyah south of Damascus, which unfortunately was bombed by these crazy people recently, but has been rebuilt. And beautiful, very beautiful mausoleum built by Persian architects from Isfahan. And originally when they began, it had something to do with it in the old days, so I'm very happy that they finished their task. But she has two remarkable mausoleums also. This system, but nobody else in Islamic history. There's nobody else. That itself is quite a remarkable fact, how God wanted the barakah, the presence of this brother and sister, to spread in two very different lands, two very different territories, two very different worlds. That itself is a kind of miracle. We don't have anything like that, for example, in the West. All these great saints of Catholicism, they have a saint. They have a sainted tomb. They have a church or something dedicated to them. You don't have someone who's buried in two places, you might say, or at least people claim. But anyone who's visited Zainabiyah outside of Damascus and has visited Zainabiyah in Cairo knows that Sayyidina Zainab is present in both. Now, where she's really buried, I think she's probably buried in Damascus, but don't let the Egyptians hear me, otherwise they'll kill me. But anyway, this presence is there. Maybe that's where she was exiled, outside of Fustat. We really do not know. Anyway, Hussein combined in himself an inner contemplative life and an outer active life. His brother Hassan, who was the first Imam of Shiism, was reversed. He had a contemplative life outward, a very quiet life, and his active life was within. It is who spread really through his progeny Islam in all of North Africa. Almost all the Shurafa, the descendants of the Prophet, North Africa, Hassan. Whereas there are some Husseinis, I'm not saying there's none, but most of the Sadat Shurafa in the eastern land of Islam, including my own family, are Husseinis. So it's not that Imam Hussein was doing nothing. were disseminating the barakah of Islam in a kind of quiet, contemplative way, where the destiny of Hussein was something else. And it led to this unique event in the history of Islam. Those of you who have not studied Islamic history might not be astounded at the remarkable effect of the death of Imam Hussein. He was killed in an empire which was the biggest empire in the world at that time, spreading from China to Spain, run by the Umayyads. And this event in the middle of a desert, in the middle of that what was then nowhere, finally brought the Umayyads down. All of the revolts against the Umayyads from Mukhtar and to finally Abu Muslim al-Khurasani, who was instrumental in the destruction of the Umayyad dynasty and the bringing of the Abbasids, were related to the Qiyam al-Hussein. So this is a very, very important, not only religious, but also historical event. It changed the history of Islam and many other countries ancillary and next to it. Imam Hussein, when he died, what did he leave behind? He left, first of all, behind what in Shiism technically is defined as walaya, the spiritual inner dimension of the function that God gave to the Prophet. The Prophet was at once Wali and Nabi, and God himself is not called Nabi, but he's called Wali. It's one of the names of God. It's his divine quality, which we Shiites believe was transmitted through Hazrat Ali alayhi salam to Hassan and Hussein and all the 12 Imams. And the Sunnis have a very similar belief in Sunni Sufism, in which Walaya is also transmitted for them also mostly through Ali. I've been to a place in Morocco where Ali is as veneer as in Qom. Many Persians do not know these things. I don't mean the Wahhabis and Salafis and all these recent deviations that are not sweeping over the Islamic world. I mean authentic traditional Islam. But for the Shiites, Walaya was concentrated in the person of Ali and the other 11 Imams, and it continues in the world through the presence of the 12th Imam, who has now died, who is alive. And therefore, Walaya is a living spiritual force and reality. It's not only of historical significance. And from this wonderful word come so many different terms I will not get into. But only one term I will mention, which is mentioned in the Quran, إِنَّا أَوْلِيَاءُ اللَّهِ لَا خَوْفَ عَلَيْهِمْ وَهُمْ لَا يَحْزَنُونَ. The awliya of God, as the plural of wali. The wali is a friend of God. And Hussein and Hassan certainly were God's very close friends. And this aspect of friendship, intimacy, nearness, is therefore something that remained within Shiism. Even popular exoteric Shiism, not only among the spiritual elite. And this is one of the gifts that we have from him. Secondly, he set the example of truthfulness, standing on his word. I'm going to come to in a moment. He produced the progeny that became the other Imams. Imam Zain al-Abidin alayhi salam was not the son of Hassan, but of Hussein. All the other Imams are descendants of Imam Hussein. They're not the descendants of Imam Hassan. So he left with his biological, you might say, inheritance, the whole chain of the Imams and all that goes with it, and the whole history of Shiism, and besides of having tremendous influence in the non-Shiite world, which I will turn to in a moment. He left behind, as I said, very few writings or saints, but this few that he has left are very precious, especially Dua Arafah, part of which was translated by Dr. William Chittick. The sayings of the Shiite Imams, which when I was in Iran, I asked Allama Tabatabai to prepare the anthology for which I've written an introduction, and then William Chittick translated it into English. And this is a remarkable, remarkable work that is recited almost every day somewhere in the Islamic world, especially in Iran and Pakistan, I'm sure in other places as well. I remember one night in Mecca when I was making the pilgrimage, the person who was with me, the Persian scholar, we sat down together exactly where Hazrat Imam Hussein had said the Dua Arafah and recited the whole Dua. So if you know the Imam were there, it was as if he were present and reciting it with us, or we with him, of course. Of course, a very beautiful work in Arabic and shows the mastery that these people had, even externally, of language, the language of Shakespeare in English. Very, very beautiful, exquisite Arabic. Now, he remained a model and still remains a model for Muslims. And I want to just mention a few of the most important traits of Seyyed Hossein, of Imam Hossein, which have served as models over the centuries and which are still very much alive, because Hossein is not dead, he's alive. Although he would not be in this room, what are we doing here? It was just a dead historical figure. Most of us would not be here, except a few scholars who might want to hear what Mutanabbi said about Arabic poetry in the 12th century or something like that. So I want to mention for you some of the very, very important points, one of which is quite subtle. And for a general audience like this, it might be difficult, but nevertheless, I have to say, Christianity is based on the idea of sacrifice. Sacrifice is central to Christianity. The central rite of Christianity is the Eucharist, the Mass. And in the Mass, all serious Christians, Catholics and Orthodox, and some of the most traditional Protestants like the Anglicans, they are participating in the sacrifice of Christ. The bread is the flesh of Christ, the wine is the blood of Christ. So they participate in the flesh and blood of Christ. That's what the spiritual significance of the Mass is. Islam is not based on sacrifice. Islam is based on La ilaha illallah, the knowledge of the oneness of God. But the major elements of human existence cannot not exist in every religion. In the same way that in Christianity, all is based on sacrifice, the Catholic credo begins, credo in unum Deum, that is La ilaha illallah. I believe in the one God in Latin, which has been recited for 2,000 years in churches. In the same way in Islam, it's in Imam Hussein and the passion of Imam Hussein, this element of sacrifice comes to the fore. In a sense, Imam Hussein is the Christ within the Muhammadan world, the Islamic world. And we must remember that he represents the supreme sacrifice for Muslims and has been the supreme exemplar of sacrificing. Of course, when he died in Karbala, he was already gone. He had already transmitted the power of the Ummah and the Walaya to Zain al-Abidin. And this human tragedy that we keep beating our heads like this in the bazaar of Tehran about, he was not in pain. He was already in another world. But from the human point of view, that of course represents the supreme sacrifice, to die for the truth. Then is the question of freedom. Freedom is a word that is flung around a great deal today. Hurriya in Arabic, Azadi in Persian. But spiritual freedom is one thing, and freedom from God is something else. Today is freedom from God that we are after. Whereas traditional society was freedom from the nafs. And when Imam Hussein speaks about freedom, it's freedom from ourselves, from our lower selves. Not only dictators and political figures and so forth. He wasn't there just to be a political reformist. It was much more than that. He's a reformer of our souls. And the question of freedom that he speaks about is several very important things. He says we cannot do this and that, at least be free. This means actually freedom to be ourselves. And to be ourselves means to be Abdullah, to be the slave of God, to be the servant of God, to be truly in surrender, taslim, from which the word Islam comes, to God himself. And then there's the great virtue of truthfulness, which is the heart of Islam itself. Islam is based on the message of the truth in its absolute sense. La ilaha illallah, it's the absolute expression of the truth. And of course, all the Imams, and especially the Prophet himself, the whole life was exemplary as far as truthfulness was concerned. But Imam Hussein was specially marked to represent this virtue, even when he was a little boy. He was always truthful about everything. He lived in the truth. And his martyrdom, in a sense, brings back over and over again the importance of truthfulness. I, as a Persian and a Muslim, criticize myself. I don't want to criticize anybody else. It's therefore a parody that so many people during Ashura in my own city, Tehran, and the bazaar suddenly become very pious and truthful. As soon as Ashura is over, they go back and sell a watermelon twice the price that they should sell. And they jip the clients and so forth and so on. This is unfortunate. But the great lesson of Ashura is truthfulness. You must finally die before the truth. If you want to love God, you must be able to realize that nothing is before Him. Allahu ghaniyun wa antum al-fuqara. What does it mean to be faqir? That means to have nothing. In the sense to die to one's ego, to one's self, to one's desires, to one's will all the time, wanting to do this and that. And he represents that, of course, at the highest level. And I want to add one other very, very important virtue, the virtue of chivalry, which has left our world so much, unfortunately. This in Persian is called Javan Mardi, and in Arabic, Fatawah. And Ali was the founder of Fatawah in Islam. He's the prophet who said to Ali, La Fata illa Ali, La Saif illa Dhul-Faqar. There is no fatah, there is no chivalry except that of Ali. There's a prophet bestowed this honor upon him. And he's the origin of chivalry. But when it comes to actual practice of everyday life, Hussein occupies a very important role, only matched by Father Ali, of being the supreme exemplar of chivalry, how to be chivalrous. Chivalry is a very, very important aspect of Islam, of Islamic spirituality, of Irfan, of Sufism. And it's very, very sad to see that our traditional culture, our adab, which derived from chivalry, has been so weakened, and especially among the younger generation of Muslims born in this country, where chivalry doesn't count for much. There, and I'm not saying there's no one who's not chivalrous, although the word would not exist in English, but which is not central as it was in our own tradition. Finally, I want to mention the role of Hussein as intercessor. It's called Shafa'a in Arabic, Shafa'at in Persian. This is an enigmatic word debated a great deal among Muslim ulama, both jurists and theologians. There are certain Sunnis who do not believe that anyone except the Prophet can perform Shafa'a, and Shafa'a is already reserved to God Himself. They don't accept the intercession of saints and of Imams. We in Shi'ism go to the other extreme. And I go to extreme because there are people who do all kinds of things, bad things, and then some preacher comes on Ashura and says, if you just have two drops of tears for Imam Hussein, all your sins will be forgiven. This is actually an affront to the Islamic Sharia, to the teaching of the Prophet. Of course, God is the forgiver. But one should keep a balance. One should keep a balance between correct action, which God expects of us, and shafa'a or intercession based on God's mercy, in the economy, spiritual economy of the Shi'ite world, Hussein plays a very, very important role, along with in Iran itself, with Ali and Hazrat Reza, the 8th Shi'ite Imam. People don't usually ask the 11th Imam for shafa'a, they don't know where his tomb is. Now there are more pilgrims going to Iraq. Of course, they bombed the beautiful mausoleum some years back, but then it's been rebuilt. But usually it's these three figures who play a very, very important necessary role. Finally, I want to mention that the whole reality of Hussein contains a very important feminine element. It's extremely important for the understanding of female spirituality in Islam, and especially in this day and age, when we have all these problems, people give courses on women in religion. There's no course in the United States on men in religion. We live in this day and age. It's very important to understand that what Zainab represents, her life is entwined with that of her brother. As I said, she's the most famous woman as far as historical action is concerned in early Islam, in fact, the whole of Islamic history. The two other women who came before her, who spiritually, of course, precede her, Khadija, the wife of the Prophet, and Fatima, her mother. But neither of them had activity in the world out there, you might say. Their activity was inward. Whereas that of course, of Khadija protected the Prophet and so forth financially, but it was limited. But Zainab is a major political figure in Islamic history. At the same time, spiritual figure. And we do not have another example like that. And one cannot really think about Imam Hussein without Hazrat Zainab, without Zainab. And especially for women, the spirituality of Zainab is a very, very precious heritage that the Prophet, through his grandson, left for all the later generation of Muslim women. Not that it's not important for men. I visited her grave, I said, when I was in Cairo every day, without Seyyed Hossein, we would also go to Seyyed Zainab. But he plays a especially important role in female spirituality in Islam. I can hardly overemphasize it. And this is inseparable from the reality of Hussein. Now, having said all of these, this is about Imam Hussein himself. I want to say a few words about things that people don't really think about usually. And that is, first of all, the role of Sayyidina Hussein, and through him of Shiism, on art, on Islamic art. Nobody thinks about this category. But it's very, very important. But first of all these beautiful madih, eulogies, poems about Hazrat Imam Hussein by Karim Kashani, others, Sahabi Tabrizi there. Persian literature is full of it, and so is Urdu. I've heard a lot of Urdu poems about Imam Hussein in India and Pakistan, and also in Arabic, some most beautiful poems in Arabic, written in Beirut, written in Damascus, written in Cairo, are about him, or about Sayyidina Hussein. After that, the poetry and literature, you have certain arts which are specifically Shiite, which emanate from the event of the death of Hussein. They would not have been there had this event not taken place. One of them is we call Rozakhani. Roza in Arabic means garden. And Rozakhani has nothing to do with gardens. It has to do with a book by Bouazza Kashafi, a famous Shiite writer, which became sort of the Bible for what they call Rozakhani. Rozakhani is an event, I'm sure we have it in Washington. Somebody gets up and talks about the tragedy of Karbala and how the various children were killed and so forth and so on, and people cry. It's a kind of catharsis. It has a very important catharsis effect. But it can also be overdone. And the many important ulama in Iran who tried to downplay the Rozakhani, which became very popular in the Safavid period for political reasons against the Ottomans. I don't want to go into the political history at the present moment, but I will just a couple examples. Ayatollah Khomeini never went to Rozakhani. My own great teacher, Allama Tabatabai, he would not go to any Rozakhani except on the morning of Ashura in Qom, when there was one preacher who talked only about really Irfan and mysticism at the highest level. And he would always take me and we would go there together. He would never go to another Rozakhani. It isn't that all of the ulama are very favorable toward this, because sometimes they feel, for some people, it takes the place of ibadah, of religious worship, even namaz, even doing good things. One thing, like having gone to Rozakhani, you sort of empty yourself. I said jokingly once in Tehran, I said we should thank Rozakhani. It saves the Iranian government millions and millions of dollars by not having any other psychologists. You pay $150 to a psychologist, and Rozakhani does that free of charge. So as tremendous psychological role of emptying oneself. And if a mother has lost a son, she goes to Rozakhani, she keeps beating her head and pulling out her hair, and she's crying about her own problems. But it's gotten a religious aspect to it. It has received God's presence and blessing. And so it ameliorates her pain inwardly. And then there are more organized and active events associated with his name. First of all, Dasteh. Dasteh is a group of people who march. And you know the marches that take place, and there's some pictures of it, now you can see it on Fifth Avenue and now in Washington a little bit. But these great Dastehs are the remarkable works of art with the alam, the flags that they carry in front and chanting, and it's really one of the major religious phenomena of the world. People come just to see it. It's a remarkable phenomenon. At 12 o'clock at noon in those days we used to go to home. All the dastas from Qom would come from various gates into the center of the Sahd, into the center of the arena in front of Hazrat Masum's mausoleum. And at exactly 12 o'clock, about 1,000 white doves were let loose, all with their wings made red with blood to represent the martyrdom of Hussein. It was a sight, really, from point of art. It was out of this world, it was a theophany. It was a theophany, just to be present and to see this. So these are very moving events. Very, very moving events. And in Pakistan and India also, they are very, very popular and very important. Most of the Shiites that are killed by Al-Qaeda in Pakistan is during these processions. During Muharram, every day 50 people killed, 40 people killed. Unfortunately, that's going on. And then there are more extreme forms of self-flagellation, you might call it, called zanjir zani, for them. You take some chains and you beat yourself until blood comes out. And some people have qami zani, they hit their head with a sword. This was forbidden by the ulama. Ayatollah Burjerdi gave a fatwa against it. But the Masjid Turkan, the Azerbaijani Turks, the Shiite Turks are very, very strong Shiites. In the Masjid Turkan at 12 o'clock at night on Tasua, I've been there 10 times, they'll close the door and they'll start qami zani until there was blood on the whole floor of the mosque. So you have extreme forms of these kinds of things, which the Shiite ulama are not happy about, that they want to understand. The frenzy that is created by the love for Hussein and the participation in the tragedy of Karbala. Otherwise, that same person who's doing that, if he goes home and somebody pricks him with a little needle, he'll get up and slap some for having pricked him with a little needle. He cannot bear the pain. But there, they bear the pain and they're very happy about it. I've seen a lot of sites that I don't want to bother you with. Finally, there's this very important art called the Taziyah. Taziyah is the only sacred theater in Islam. In Islam, because of the perspective, which is noetic, based on knowledge, la ilaha illallah, there was not this tension between the gods and men that is the origin of Greek play, Greek theater, Greek tragedy. Can you imagine there is not a word for tragedy in Arabic? There's not a word for tragedy in Persian. All the works translated from the Greeks. You don't have the word for tragedy. And the Greek tragedies were translated in the 19th century into Arabic. With all the translations that were made in the early centuries of philosophy, of theology, of mathematics, of social laws, everything, none of the tragedies were translated. Thucydides and Sophocles and the great playwrights. This is alien to the Islamic perspective, but again, like what I said before, it had to manifest itself somewhere. And the two civilizations next to Islam, Hinduism and Christianity, sacred theater or play is very, very significant. Very significant. In Islam, the only place that we have it is in the Taziyah. And the Taziyah has produced some remarkable art. In the city of Lucknow, in Uttar Pradesh, in northern India, there's a place called Imambara, where they keep the paraphernalia of the Taziyah. The horse of Hazrat Abbas is the size of this room. Everything in India is big, even cucumbers are this size. Everything grows a bit. You just cannot imagine what takes place. If you're ever in Lucknow during the month of Muharram, it's worth it, much better than seeing the best play in New York. I'm just from the point of art, theatrical art, but it's also combined with tremendous feeling and tragedy called the Taziyah, the passion play, and we could not talk about Imam Hussein without talking about it. But he is the central figure of the Taziyah. You can have Taziyahs of other people, Hazrat al-Akbar, this, that. There are even Taziyahs of Rustam and Sohrab, which have been Islamicized. And in Khorasan, oftentimes during Muharram, in the afternoon, people go to the Taziyah of Rustam Sohrab from the Shahnameh, and in the evening to the Taziyah of Saddam Hussein. The pre-Islamic history of the great tragedy of the death of Sohrab in the hand of his father, Rustam, which is one of the great moments of tragedy in world literature, have been integrated into the tragedy of Imam Hussein, which is very, very interesting. I've seen that in my own eyes in the small towns in Khorasan. It's still going on. I hope it's still going on. Now, the celebrations of Ashura, which have to do with Saddam Hussein, have a tremendous cathartic effect. I find also cleansing the psychological ambience and the social ambience of society as a whole. And they have been therefore used but also misused many times. But in the history of Islam, sometimes they've been misused to bring about frenzy and political machinations or events and actions and so forth and so on. I'm not going to go into that, but I want to express to you that something so macro, so big, that involves the whole of society cannot but have also a social and political dimension to it. But it's the inner dimension that is really important. Let's give you one example of it. When I was in Iran, one of the Pakistani ambassadors who had just come was called General Reza. He was one of the leading Pakistani generals. And he was a very devout Shia. He called me up on the morning of Hasura. I said, Dr. Nasr, what is Sinizani? I said, what, you want to go to Sinizani? He said, no, I want to participate. Can you imagine the Iran of that time? An ambassador of a foreign country bearing his shirt and Sinizani in front of the dasse, in front of the group. And he did that. I went with him. And so you had this intensity, which is really quite remarkable, and which I want to leave with you. And also, I want to leave with you the idea that the celebration, I would call it, not only the sad part, but the celebration, really, not the commemoration, the celebration, really, of the martyrdom of Hussein, is not limited to the Shiite world. It's not limited to Iran, Iraq, and Pakistan. It's also found very much in the Sunni world. And I want to recount a personal experience. In my young days, I was traveling in Morocco, and it was Tasua. And with a 5 o'clock in the afternoon, we're driving from Fez to Meknes, to Rabat. And that crosses right outside of the gates of the city of Meknes, which was the royal city and still had beautiful gates. And as the car was passing, I saw a large crowd standing over there. I told my Moroccan friend driver, what's going on? Stop, see what's happening. So we went there, and there was a Moroccan about 22, 23 years old with what you call in Persian dotar, an instrument with only two strings. You have setar, and a potar itself, which has four strings, and you have dotar, which is rare. Now we have only Mozart in Kurdistan. But we have it also in Tehran. Playing the dotar and singing in Arabic song about Imam Hossein. And there were about 1,000 Moroccans who were crying. It's as if you were in Najaf or Qom. There was not a single Shiite there. Nobody had heard of Shiism. Because when I was first went to Morocco, I was a Shiite. They said, what is that? It was like the ordinary people in the bazaar. Now, of course, they know. So barakah of Imam Hussein goes beyond the borders of Shiism into the Sunni world, into popular piety in many, many Sunni countries, excluding, of course, Arabia. I'm not talking about places which are more or less heretical in their views of Islam, at least they're extremists. I don't care this and that in my life. If I don't go to Mecca again, you have to call a spade a spade. That is not Orthodox Islam, that is not traditional Islam, that is not the heritage of the Prophet, nor of our great sages, nor even of the Khulafa, Rashidin, the Khulafa of Sunnism. But there, of course, is an exception. But everywhere else, there's a presence of Sayyidina Hussein. And so, I want to conclude by saying, what is the significance of Imam Hussein today? Some people, young people, who went to fight in the Iraqi war, and 1 million Iranians and Iraqis were killed. 1 million. Most of whom were Shiites, but not on the Persian side, a lot of the Iraqis were also Shiites. It was a great, very, very great tragedy. Many of them would have a band around their head, Ya Hussein. The idea of this kind of outward jihad or sacrifice, of course, has always been there. Many movements have begun militarily, politically, in his name. But his significance is much more than that. His significance for us in a world of relativity, a world that relativizes everything, is that there is such a thing as the truth. And it's by the truth that we should live, and by the truth that we should die. And that by giving ourselves to the truth, we gain immortality in the positive sense of the term. We live in God's grace. And so this remarkable man, nobody can have his courage, nobody could be a warrior like him, of course. But the spiritual and moral characters of Imam Hussein, far from being something that just makes people busy doing a Muharram and they make a little halwa or something like that and invite people to Rose of Honey, it's much more than that. To set a living example, along with that of his father and grandfather, for everyone, of how to live upright, how to live virtuously, especially like a time like our own, in which there's so little truth around, so much falsehood abounds everywhere, in which everyone has become the slave of the immediate interests that they have, in which you have forgotten principles. It's good to live with principles. This should be to die for principles. Not everyone is asked to make the supreme sacrifice of Hussein physically. That's not possible, and God wouldn't expect it of our people. But all of us are expected to make it inwardly, to do so inwardly, to give ourselves a truth which transcends us and finally saves us from the greatest enemy, which is not Yazid outside, but the nafs within ourselves. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Dr. Nasr, and thank you everyone for coming.